Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Joel Rosen. I am the Adrenal Fatigue Recovery Ninja, and I want to welcome you back to another edition of your Adrenal Fix. Again, impromptu, meaning I wasn't planning on doing this, and I had a cancellation, and I was able to put aside a couple moments to help you guys. And so today we are going to be talking about anxiety, adrenal fatigue, overwhelm, panic, and it's really apropos because we have an in-office workshop to educate the community tonight about anxiety and not so much adrenal fatigue, because a lot of people don't know what that is if you ask them, hey, do you know what about adrenal fatigue? But you guys are in my adrenal fatigue group and you understand what that's all about. So what I wanted to do is, first of all, I wanted to talk to you about the genetic connection. So usually people will ask me about the MTHFR component and how does that have to do with anxiety. So MTHFR is very, very important for something called Bioptrin or tetrahydrobioptrin. And Bioptrin is recycled and remade or reloaded or repacked by methyl folate. So if you don't have a methyl folate production that's optimized because of an MTHFR problem, meaning your DNA does not code for the enzyme effectively. So if you're under stress and you need to be able to deal with, make adrenaline, make neurotransmitters, make dopamine, make serotonin, then that methyl folate is very, very important to recycle that bioptrin and make it available. And if it doesn't make it available, actually, I think you guys are looking at my screen backwards. Let's see if I can change that. Let's see if I put Joel. Nope, it's backwards. All right, sorry about that. I can change it. I'm really cool now. I can change it in the middle of there. How cool is that? All right, so so back to the methyl folate. It's very important for recycling bioptrin. And bioptrin is a cofactor for us to be able to make, synthesize serotonin, dopamine, norepinephrine, epinephrine. So what I'm gonna talk about, I shouldn't have these all in red, because then you're gonna think everything's bad. So let's change that around. So I usually like to talk about, we have the excitatory pool and we have the inhibitory pool. Now, this is what makes this so complicated, is that if you have too much excitatory and not enough inhibitory, you're gonna be excited. And when we say excited, you feel like you're in fight or flight. You can't turn off the adrenaline. And if you have too much inhibitory and not enough excitatory, you're gonna be in inhibition mode. And that's gonna be perhaps depression and not feeling contentment and just not really getting a lot of pleasure out of your foods or your life. And you're like, yeah, I got a good life. I got a good family. I got a good job, but nah, I'm not really happy with things. That's a serotonin potential thing. That's too much inhibitory and not enough excitatory. But sometimes we can have both. We can have a lot of excitatory, a lot of inhibitory, but which one's winning out? Maybe both of them are causing problems. Or sometimes we can have both, not enough inhibitory, not enough excitatory. So it makes it very complicated, because when you throw on top of that epigenetic factors, which we're going to talk about in a second, you have these genetic factors that make you more likely to have too much excitatory or not enough inhibitory, or vice versa. And a lot of the times it's the perfect storm. And I want to talk to you about that perfect storm. So number one is the methyl folate problem. If you have a methyl folate problem, then you're going to have a problem with making bioptrin. And bioptrin is a cofactor. So when we say cofactors, it's necessary for the reaction to take place. Almost like if I was on a highway and I wanted to go on a tollway, if I didn't have a transponder or a coin, I wouldn't be able to go, in theory, on that highway. Although a lot of us do that and then we get a ticket in the mail. But this is not the Florida Turnpike. So anyways, so a couple other things that I want to talk to you about is protein absorption. So phenylalanine, tyrosine, tryptophan. Those are all really, really important for you to be able to synthesize, meaning fill up the bucket. So we have this excitatory bucket that needs protein and bioptrin to be able to fill up the inhibitory bucket and to fill up the excitatory bucket. So those are really, really important. So now how does that have to do with anxiety? What we talked about the methylation component and not recycling Bioptrin, but now we're talking about protein. So what happens if you're not eating enough protein? A lot of people don't eat enough protein. Then you're not gonna have the raw materials that you need. What happens if you're not absorbing your protein? A lot of the times you're not. You're not making enough hydrochloric acid because you've been eating foods that have been highly heated and highly processed your whole life, and now you've lost the ability to secrete stomach acid. Or you have a major infection. You have bacteria overgrowth, you have candida, you have yeast, you have fungus, you have maybe virals, molds, mycotoxins, and that's gonna decrease your ability to make proteins. Further complicating the matter is if you have inflammation, you're gonna steal away some of that tryptophan that would otherwise go down this pathway. And we see a lot of that where someone has a bacteria infection and they're really depressed. And there's that gut-brain access. So that's a triple whammy, right? Because on one hand, you have a methylfolate problem. On the other hand, you're not absorbing your protein because you're either not getting enough or you're not absorbing it, or you're not making enough hydrochloric acid. And then the triple whammy is you have a major infection and the protein that you do take is going to fund your excitatory mechanism. And now you have this excitatory stimulation that you can't get out of overwhelm and you can't calm down. Number three, now we also have potentially a iron problem. And by the way, just in case my wife is watching, she was telling me the other day, don't tell her this, but she was saying, I can't believe how unprofessional you are. You have videos and the phone's ringing in the background. And I told her, I do Facebook live sessions. And until I have my own studio and I have my own cameras and I can control my own environment, the phone might ring. But we're working on it. So anyway, she's my toughest critic. So the last thing is iron. Iron is also a cofactor. So we have a quadruple whammy. We have iron not being available. Now, why would iron not be available? Iron's not gonna be available for a couple reasons. Number one, liver is not doing a good job. Liver is overworked and it's not storing things. And when you have a liver inflammation, congestion, fatty liver, it's gonna spill out its contents. And iron could go, your ferritin could go really, really low. Sometimes people will say, well, I have really high ferritin. That's not good either, because that's an acute phase reactant and that's telling me you have some inflammation. You probably have some of this going on and you're not absorbing and making your proteins. But one of the other reasons we could have iron issues, because the same reasons that you weren't able to secrete enough stomach acid would be the same reasons you're not getting iron. You're not liberating it from the protein because you can't break it down effectively. And then another reason could be, let's say you do have a microbiome disruption, you have dysbiosis or unhealthy bacteria in the gut, candida overgrowth, or all of the above. You have an ecosystem, and that ecosystem is being competed for with other microbes, and they're poaching on the iron. They really are, and they're reinforcing. It's like a war going on in there. So as a result, you have low iron, so you can't convert. You can't get across the bridge, or you can't get across the bridge and you're funneling down. So all of a sudden, this bucket is not filling up. And I always say, what happens to a lake or a stream or a pond that's old and it doesn't have new water coming in and it doesn't have old water going out? It becomes stagnant. And as a result, you have this sort of oxidized little swamp of dopamine and adrenaline that doesn't go away. So a lot of people will say, yeah, when I get stressed, it can't stop thinking about it. Perhaps that's what's going on. You're not clearing out your dopamine effectively. Now, that's another thing, getting into genetics. So we're talking about synthesizing, talking about making. So you're probably not getting a lot of new flowing nutrients in there. And that's where tyrosine, phenylalanine, 5-HTP, those could all be really, really helpful. But I wouldn't recommend those unless I'm looking at your organic acid test and I know what's going on with your genetics. So we're not guessing. But anyways, so there's a synthesizing problem, but there's also a metabolizing problem, meaning you're not getting rid of it. Now, SAMe, which is so important for methylfolate to help make SAMe, is necessary to clear out dopamine. And sometimes you'll have an enzyme that is sped up, like COMT can be really sped up. So you could have a double whammy where you're not getting a lot of flowing nutrients because of a methylfolate, not recycling bioptrin, not having iron, not absorbing your protein, stealing it down. So a little bit of it is flowing here, and you're always looking for that next hit, like an ADD kid. Like, it's like you just gotta constantly be stimulated and you can't focus because you're always looking for that little dopamine surge. Anything that you can add a little bit of an aholic to, like a shopaholic or, you know, readaholic or alcoholic, that's typically someone that's going to have clearing out of dopamine very quickly, and they're not potentially having a lot of flowing into there very well. And that's a double whammy, right? Because on the one hand, you're not bringing in a lot of nutrients to make the thing, and then on the other hand, you're clearing out way too quickly. So that's a problem. That's called a fast COMT. Sometimes you'll have a slow COMT, and that could be actually beneficial, right? Because for someone that doesn't bring a lot of flow in there, if they have a slow COMT, that could be really bad, because what's happening is good, because it allows them to get a little more shelf life out of the little bit of like wringing out that sponge and wringing it out. It's hanging out a lot longer. And that's what they use in terms of selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or even the dopamine reuptake inhibitors, because those don't allow those to clear out as quick. Now, sometimes people will say, well, I took methylfolate and it made me more anxious. What probably happened was it brought more in there, but because this cycle is not spinning very well, you don't have SAMe as a cofactor and you're not able to clear it out. So now all of a sudden it didn't work in your favor because you're bringing in so much more nutrients that is hanging out so much longer. And it's like me, I got a slow COMT. So what will happen is I'll get to, you know, the lights and someone will almost hit me from behind or from in front, and I'll still be freaking out like 15, 20 minutes later. I'm still in overwhelm, and I should have my SAMe in my pocket so I can take that and help clear that out. So anyways, hopefully that was helpful. Those were the things that I wanted to talk to you about. The other thing I wanted to talk to you about is sometimes we'll do a Nutricell SpectraCell test. And the SpectraCell test with anxiety is pretty important. We have this chart here. So, you know, things like folate, obviously, aids in the production of neurotransmitters. So you guys are pros at this right now because I just gave you the physiology. But folate aids in the production of neurotransmitters such as dopamine and serotonin, which have a calming effect. So we already kind of took you through that pathway. But chromium, it impacts serotonin. Carnitine helps with well-being. Vitamin D and vitamin E are very important. B vitamins, zinc. So if you're not absorbing your minerals, your micronutrients, these are cofactors, and these cofactors become main factors. So anyways, hopefully you found that really, really helpful. It's not just about taking your anti-anxiety medications. It has a lot to do with understanding the genetics and understanding your absorption. So hopefully that made a lot of sense, and that's all I got for you. So my name is Dr. Joel Rosen. I am the Adrenal Fatigue Recovery Ninja, and I look forward to ending your adrenal fatigue and anxiety nightmare. Have a wonderful day. Yes.